introducing myself. I'm Terry Morris, my wife Susan, and we pastor a church called Sojourn Church. It's in Carrollton, Texas, which is in the North Dallas area, nearly to Plano. We've known each other since first grade. So we have known each other since we were 6 years old. We went through grade school, junior high school, and college, got married after college, and I have a degree in business and had no intentions of being a pastor. And she had no intentions of being a pastor's wife. So, but God had different intentions. And He is good and faithful, and we just rejoice in what He has done in our lives. So, we'll share.
Good afternoon. I just want to share just a little bit. We went to Toronto in 1994, 6 weeks after the Toronto blessing broke out. And when we went, honestly, the church there, it was in the small airport vineyard church, and it was no larger than really these two small sections. And, you know, you have in your mind what a revival is going to be like. So we got there early. We had never met Carol and John, and we got there early, and we walked in and thinking it would be just lines of people waiting for this revival. And when we got there, it was, I think there were about 10 of us who came from Texas. It was us 10 and the nursery worker. And we thought, whoa! But honestly, it changed our life. It was so precious what God did. We got to go for a week, and Terry spoke for a week at the Toronto Vineyard, and then 65 people from our church came up with us, and we were the ministry team. So it was fabulous, and it just was wonderful. John oftentimes lets me speak when I go there, but I think it's not to hear what I have to say. I think it's to hear my accent. And so we are close friends with John and Carol. We count it an honor and a blessing from the Lord just to be a part of what He is doing. And we're just real privileged just to stand before you and share the goodness of the Lord. And I'm going to join you, and Terry's going to share his the teaching that the Lord's given him.
Thank you. I'll tell you a little bit more about my background. I was raised in church. I was raised in a Christian home and grew up on a farm, actually not very far from the little town of Corsicana, which is about 50 miles south of Dallas. And grew up in a godly home and attended church really all my life. And we got married, and we began to continue to just go to church, good church members. But about 31 years of age, after pursuing, I was in business and just working, and I found myself in church every Sunday, literally going to church, going to Bible studies, reading my Bible, praying, and even taking some. We were at the time there was a called the Lay Institute down at Dallas Seminary. You could go on Monday nights, and the graduate students would teach, and we went there, and it was sort of our night out. Doing all of that and doing everything that they told me to do in church, I found myself absolutely defeated in life. Thinking that I'm doing everything that I'm supposed to do, but absolutely no victory in my life. I had a terrible temper that I couldn't control, and I had had hurt my back, and didn't know how to really handle that. So somebody with a bad back, and some of you've got bad backs, you know what that's like. With a bad temper you couldn't control, I was pretty miserable. I had taken what I thought was a lot of money and turned it into a little bit of money and a lot of debt. Wasn't too hard to do. Worked hard at it, but I was able to do that. And really frustrated the time of my life. And we had back because of our roots, my roots were Southern Baptist. And through those roots, we had gotten to be friends and supporters of James Robinson, who's, if you know who James is, but he's local here and then he's on TV now. But we'd been going to his meetings and got to be friends. And we had, every 6 months or so, he'd have a meeting we'd go to, and he'd have a big Bible conference here. And in August of 82, we went to a meeting where James shared about how God had changed his life and how God had touched him and really through the Word of God had literally changed his life and delivered him of evil spirits and all kinds of things. And I literally had a Damascus Road experience in August of 82. I went one way and came back absolutely totally different, transformed. I got delivered of evil spirits, which, again, whatever your theology is on that, all I know is something left. And some came in. And what left was bad, and what came in was good. And I really believe I was born again and I would have gone to heaven, but I got filled with the Spirit, which I didn't know what that was. I received the love of the Father as a revelation, not just in my head, but in my heart. And that was August of 82. I was in business. I was in the oil and gas business and went one way. One weekend came back absolutely totally different, transformed. That began a journey in our lives that we had no intentions of pastoring a church or anything else, but we just began to pursue the Lord. And we wasn't long after that where we got introduced to others who had been introduced to the Holy Spirit and learned about spiritual warfare. The good news that that battle, I tell people, I found out that there was a war going on, and I'd already been taken captive. I wasn't even in the battle. But thanks be to God, He sets us free, and He set me free. But that process, we began to just continue to pursue the Lord. That was really our heart's desire. We started with a group in our home, had about 10 or 12 people, and that grew to 20 to 30 to 40 to 50. And in 1987, I actually quit business, and in January of 87, started a church called Sojourn Church that meets on Sojourn Drive. That's how you get the name. But we began with the simple desire to worship the Lord, to try our best to live by His Word, and to allow the Holy Spirit to empower us to work through us to help people. And so when we've been very good friends with the Vineyard. We'd met John Wimber back in the early 80s and very much influenced by John Wimber and teaching of body ministry and all of that. And so we've been involved in deliverance, inner healing, and every kind of ministry you can think of. And our heart's desire from the beginning is to help people get free so that, because free people will free people. People that know the love of God can release the love of God to others. And, you know, the world we live in is a difficult, tough place. So our journey to Toronto began in, it was February of 94. And we had a good friend that we had been using. He was an attorney. And, we'd use him and we'd call him on the phone and, you know, he'd usually get his voicemail because he's always busy. And he'd say, you know, Greek cop so-and-so, leave your telephone number, your name, your telephone number, I'll call you right back. Well, we called this day in February of 1994 and we get this message, you've reached the office of so-and-so and you can leave your name and telephone number if you'd like to. I don't know if I'll call you back or not because we're having a revival. I go, that's great. Thanks for the, you know, I've got this message. Now, what do we do with this? Well, we found out that revival was going on in Toronto. And just a week or two later, we had the opportunity to go there. It was March of 94. And really just got soaked in the river. We had a group from our church that went there. We came back and began to minister here in the Dallas area and released the love of God and the power of God, and had John and Carol have come in a number of times and been a tremendous blessing for us. But over those years, through this whole journey, the Lord has been speaking something to me, and I want to go back here and talk about what we're here for, is talking about the cross as the key. A number of years ago, I was reading in Matthew 16, and I was reading the passage of Scripture where Jesus asked the disciples, who do they say that I am? And they said, well, some say you're Elijah, some say John the Baptist. He said, but who do you say that I am? And they said, and Peter says, well, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, you know, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father revealed this to you. And Peter, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of Hades will not prevail. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom. And whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose will be loosed. Well, when I was studying that, the Lord was revealing to me the issues of the kingdom of God. Much like Jack shared this morning, the kingdom of God. And I was struggling with that issue. You know, that's not an easy concept, especially in America, because we don't have a king, and we don't understand a kingdom, and we don't really understand that. We think it's a democracy, and we all get a vote. And that's how we've been raised. But understanding the king and his kingdom, and I was struggling with it. I knew God was trying to show me something. And about the time as I was reading that, I had a vision of an old skeleton key. And I remember when I was a little boy going to my grandmother's house, and there was an old tiny skeleton key. I don't, you remember, but it looked sort of ornate on the end. It was long and had some little teeth. It was in this, I don't know what kind of piece of furniture it was. All I know as a little kid, I'd get that key out and run around with my grandmother and say, don't lose that key, don't lose that key. You know, which was, I don't know why she'd tell me that. Probably because I'd lose everything that get my hands on. But I saw in my mind's eye that quick picture of that key. And I knew the Lord was trying to give me something, but I didn't understand it. I knew it had to do with the kingdom of God. I knew it had to do with keys. And I knew, you know, I could read and understand, but I knew there was something deeper that he was trying to reveal to me. A couple of years later, I was watching, I think it was TVN, and the person preaching was behind a clear lectern, and on the very front of it was a very ornate cross. And that cross was etched into the front of it, and as it went down, and it was real fancy at the top, and it looked just like that vision I had of that key. And the Lord spoke to me and says, the cross is the key. The cross is the key to victory. It's the key to the power of God in your life. It's the key. Understanding, and when I'm talking about the cross, I'm talking about the Jesus' life right before the cross, is obviously his crucifixion, his burial, and his resurrection. But understanding what Jesus did 2,000 years ago, we've got a friend who says, that was the most important event that has ever occurred. Not something that's coming in the future, and I thank God for Jesus coming and returning. So the most important event that ever happened was happened with Jesus Christ, of coming and living on earth, going to the cross and dying for us. And it's time for us as believers to walk in what Jesus has already paid for. I do not want to get to heaven and find out that there was all this that I could have had, but I just didn't know, or I didn't walk in it, or I didn't appropriate the fullness of what Jesus paid for at the cross. So if you have your Bibles, you might just open it and let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. We're going to do a number of things here. I'm actually in the process of writing a book on this because I think it's so important. This is something that I don't see much about. I know that there was a book that Billheimer did on Destined to the Cross and Destined to the Throne. The Destined to the Cross I cannot find. You may have it. If you do, I'd love to have a copy of it. But it's out of print and can't find it. But there's very few books out there on the cross. Now, years ago, that was a major subject. But over the last 20 years or so, there hasn't been much on the cross. But 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. And let me just start by saying this. The cross represents so much. And all I want to do today is try to paint a picture so that you can begin to get into your, not only into your mind, but into your spirit, some of these things to try to help you remember. Every time that I see a cross, every time that I see something that resembles a cross, if I'm driving down the road and I see something that just sort of looks like a cross, I'm asking the Holy Spirit to remind me of the power of the cross, the message of the cross, and I'm going to start talking about the various things. One of the most important things is that though it represented the most hideous form of death of that day and time, for us who are believers, it represents life. Now, my God caused life to come out of death. It says in Isaiah, he causes beauty to come out of ashes. Isn't that amazing? If you've ever seen ashes, when something is burned to ashes, there's nothing left. I mean, there is just nothing there. Well, my God causes beauty to come out of ashes, and he causes life to come out of death. Now, I don't know of anybody who hadn't experienced death in their life and had experienced some real disappointments and hurts and wounds. I'll tell you, my God causes life to come out of that. And he can in every one of our lives. And what Jack was sharing about this morning about the kingdom of God, when Jesus came, he preached the kingdom of God. If you go and read the scriptures, you'll see the message that he preached was the gospel of the kingdom of God. He didn't preach a gospel of salvation. We preach the gospel of salvation. You need to get saved. And you do. That's the beginning, not the end. You understand? The beginning is the door, that's salvation, but Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom of God. He said that it is now, it's at hand. He demonstrated the kingdom of God by praying for people, healing people, casting out demons, and then he literally made disciples and said, now I want you to go do the same. And so the message is the kingdom of God. But what I want to talk about, and I'm going to just give an overview of this, and this is what I believe that the Lord is saying to us. Number one, and if you have some way to take notes, I'm just going to ask you to write these little points down. Number one, the cross represents, first thing and foremost, the love of the Father. So we're going to come back and touch on each one of these. I'm just going to talk about it real briefly. Number one, the first thing I'm going to ask you to do every time you see a cross is that you think, wow, how much my Father loves me that He would send His Son to die on the cross for me. We need to know the love of the Father. John has been ministering the love of the Father since I met him in 1994. The still the most important thing probably that I see as I travel, and I get to travel all over the world, is that, again, people need to know the love of the Father. People sitting in church and have been in church for 30 and 40 years and still don't know the love of the Father. They can pass the test, but they don't really know it in their heart. And that's what changed their life. The second thing that the cross represents is this whole position of our new identity in Christ. We were redeemed. We were forgiven. We've been made righteous. We've been cleansed. We've been sanctified. We've been reconciled to God. We've been brought into the family. We're children of God. We're joint heirs with Jesus. We're accepted in the beloved. That's just a few. I mean, that's who we are. That's me. That's who I am. That's who you are. And it's time for us to receive the love of the Father and appropriate what He paid for by His Word. And so it'll change your life. You'll begin to live differently when we discover His love and our identity of who we really are. My identity is not in being a man, or it's not in being a pastor. It's not in being, it's not in anything other than who the Lord says that I am. I'm a child of God, a joint heir with Jesus. The third thing we'll talk about, and we'll talk about briefly, is the exchange of the cross. Derek Prince did a teaching on the exchange of the cross, but it's a powerful, when you look at what Jesus really did, He took our sin and all these things, He took upon Himself, and we can exchange our sickness for His health. We can exchange various things that we, you know, the exchange of the cross is the most lopsided exchange there ever was. I mean, we have nothing to give. Jesus said everything. He gave us all. It says we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. He gave all of that to us, and we gave Him all of our garbage. Isn't that amazing? But many of us have not made the exchange the way we need to. Now, the fourth thing is that at the cross, Jesus absolutely and totally defeated the devil. He is absolutely and completely defeated. And it's time for us to recognize that and to live in the victory of the cross. It's not because I did something great, it's because Jesus did. But He made an open and public display of the enemy, having triumphed over him completely, absolutely, totally. Now, He's still around, and He's like a roaring lion seeking whom He may devour. So we don't need to act silly about it, but we need to appropriate the victory of the cross and understand that in our lives. The fifth thing is the power of the cross. Romans chapter 6 says that do you not understand that if you were buried with Christ and identify with His death, that you're also raised to walk in newness of life, and that no longer sin should rule in your life? You're no longer a slave of sin. If we would understand our identity in the death, burial, and resurrection, we'd live different. Now, you can't live Romans 6 out of Romans 7. What I do, what I don't want to do, what I do when I'm doing all this stuff. Well, go in Romans 7, you'll count I, me, my 34, 35 times in those 10 verses. That's the problem. The big I. The big me. You live Romans 6 out of Romans 8 by the Spirit. But by the Spirit, there's no condemnation. By the Spirit, we live in the power of God. And then lastly, if we really want to be a disciple of Jesus, we've got to deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and follow Jesus. But about the only preaching I've ever heard on the cross is just beat ourselves up, you know, instead of understanding the reality of what Jesus has done, appropriating that by faith into our lives, and then from there we can begin to go, wow, this is good. I can live this by the power of the Spirit. Now, I want us to pray, and then we're going to talk about some of these. And there's no way to talk about all this in detail, but I do want to talk about, obviously, some of these, and we'll touch on them. We'll have ministry in some of these areas, because we, you know, it's one thing to talk about, it's another thing to receive it into our lives. Let's pray. Father, we love you and bless you. And we thank you that you have loved us with an everlasting love. Oh, Lord, we love you. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the cross. We thank you that you would go to the cross and you would literally die our death. You take our sin upon you. And Lord, we're so thankful that you have forgiven us completely. Lord, we love you. And we bless you. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you reveal truth to us. And I'm asking that you would come and lead us and guide us and direct us this afternoon so that the truth of this message, the message of the cross, which is for us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Oh, Lord, give us revelation. Oh, Holy Spirit, make it real to us, not just intellectually, but real in our spirit, in our deepest, innermost parts, so that we can walk it out and live it out. Lord, we love you, and we bless you, and we just thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody knows John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We all know that. If you've ever been to church, you've got John 3:16, and probably one of the most popular verses. But you know, if we gave everybody a test and said, do you believe that God loves you? We'd all go, oh yeah, God loves me, I know. But the truth is, God really wants to get it deep into our heart. He wants to soak us. That's the one thing I got in Toronto. I remember we'd seen ministry before, and we'd seen people falling out, and we'd seen people getting filled with the Spirit, and we'd seen people getting prayed for and all that. But the two things, I remember John kept saying, goes, but if you've been prayed for, and you go out in the Spirit, just stay there. Don't jump up. Yeah, I'm used to being him. You know, man, they go down, they jerk them off. They just jerk their arms off. Isn't that right? I mean, they pull them up off the floor, you know. And so I said, well, I never heard that before. But he said, just rest there. Don't get up until the Lord is through. And before you get up, ask if he wants to do more. Well, that's sort of unique. I've never seen that before, but wow, it was blessing. And then the other thing it's saying is, hey, you've been prayed for, get prayed for again. You know, most of the times you get in line, you get prayed for once, and you say, well, I shouldn't go back up there. I've been prayed for once. You know, oh, get prayed for again. You know, so I'm still getting prayed for. Still getting prayed for. But I went home after Toronto, and I really felt like that we started meetings on every night, and we came home, and but we had a commitment in Albuquerque. Myself and associate had to go over there for a meeting, and so actually Susan and some of the other guys started the meetings. We were not even there. And as I came back after a couple of days, I knew they'd been meeting every night, and as we were coming back, I really felt like, you know, I don't believe I got as much as Susan did, and maybe some of the other people had gone there. And so that evening when we kicked off the ministry, I said, you know, whoever wants to get prayed for, get prayed for. I'm going to get prayed for first. So I'm the one that jumped around there and said, I'm going to get prayed for first. I wanted Susan to pray for me. Well, the power of God hit me and I was out. And I was there on the floor. And the sensation of I felt like somebody had their right hand right on my chest. Really strong pressure on my chest. And, you know, I knew it was God. I knew it was the Lord. I knew he was just releasing his love to me. I knew it was. But then all of a sudden my thinking kicked in. You know, I'm thinking, who is it that's praying for me? But then the Spirit would say, it's me. It's the Lord. But then my carnal thinking would say, who is that that's praying for me? So, you know, being real spiritual, I just laid there and opened my eyes to see. You know? And I opened my eyes. There's nobody there. There was nobody praying for me. And I knew it was the Lord, but it was just releasing the love of the Father. And God wants to release his love to us in a personal way. And he wants us to understand there are some interesting things receiving the love of the Father. And I just want to talk about some of these. I mean, the Bible is so clear. I mean, when Romans says that Jesus that God demonstrated his love toward us, and while we were sinners, you know, Jesus went to the cross and died for us. Isn't that amazing? That is amazing. Now, while we were sinners, we get over to Romans 8:32, and it says, you know, if God didn't withhold his only Son, in fact, delivered him up for us, how will he not give us all things through him? You know, and then we go, well, you know, I don't know if God loves me. You know, I don't know if, you know, I really don't know if God loves me personally. I know he loves that preacher up there, and, you know, he loves John, but I don't know if he loves me. No, God loves you. He loves you personally. Not only does God so love the world, but he loves you personally, and he loves me. But it's so important for us to understand that he really does love us, that he paid for and demonstrated with his very life. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that is amazing. That he would go and do all the things, which we'll talk about some of those, but it's so important for us to understand this awesome love that he really has for us. But I was laying there, and I received that love, and I have ever since then, actually ever since Toronto, but ever since that too, what's happened is that the Holy Spirit, if you will allow him to, he will make things, you know, deeper and deeper to you. Now, if you have your Bibles, if you'll turn with me to Romans chapter 8, I believe we were created in love because God said we were created in his image and God's love. Unfortunately, man fell and sin entered in and separated us from God, but he's been trying to get us restored ever since then. But Romans chapter 8 is a passage of Scripture. Verse 15, it says, "For I did not give to you the spirit of bondage again into fear." You didn't receive that. "But you have received the Spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together." Now, I believe that the Holy Spirit wants to reveal the love of the Father to us. He wants to reveal revelation of the cross. But here's some things that if you really want to know the love of the Father, I believe that you've got to deal with. Number one, you've got to believe that he loves you. It's just simply, you've got to believe that. You've got to look at the cross, and when you look at that cross, you've got to realize that he really was beaten. They beat them. They said 39 minus 1 because 40 stripes, you could kill somebody. I mean, he was beaten through to the bone. I mean, this is not a light whipping. He was mocked, spit upon, and he was nailed to that cross, and he died a horrible death to demonstrate how much God loves us. Isn't that amazing? But you got to believe that. I mean, the cross is not just some symbol. It's not just something we hang around our necks or we see hanging on the wall. It is a real thing that Jesus did. The second thing we've got to do is that we've really got to receive the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of adoption that releases the love of the Father into our lives. The third thing you've got to do is that you've got to understand that we do project our earthly Father's image onto our Heavenly Father. And you've got to be careful that you've got to realize that if you had a good father or a bad father, God's not like our earthly father. But they do project, we do have a tendency to project upon God our earthly father's image. You've got to be careful not to do that. Because if your father abandoned you, then you'll think God will abandon you. If your father was abusive, then you think you'll have a tendency to not want to embrace the love of the Father. If your father was just sort of not around or whatever, you know, that's what you'll begin to project. Though you'll believe and you'll want to receive the love of the Father, you'll project that upon there. And the fourth thing is that you've got to learn how to forgive one another. You've really got to forgive. Because God is love. And he wants us to love him, and he does love us, but I believe that forgiveness and choosing to forgive and release people is really love in action. Now, if you will, let's all stand up. I want to pray for us just as a mass prayer. I believe God wants to give us revelation of his love. I believe that it's the most life-transforming thing there is, but it's not the only thing. There's even more. It releases something into us. So if you will, let me just pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your awesome love. And Lord, I want to pray this prayer over everybody here that's out of Ephesians. It says, "For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant to you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, length, and depth, and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Now, Lord, I ask that you would make the love of the Father real to every one of us. I ask that you, Holy Spirit, would release your power and your ministry deep into us, that we would understand the cross, that we would see the cross, and you would remind us of how much you loved us because you went to the cross and you died a horrible death that we might have life. Lord, your word says that we didn't first love you, but you first loved us. And so, Lord, we thank you for your love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Lord, we love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, let me just say, for being seated, God is not angry with you. God is not angry. People still believe that God's got a hammer over you, and if you mess up one little bit, he'll get you. God is not. The word propitiation in that 1 John passage means that God's wrath was appeased upon Jesus Christ at the cross. That's good news. And this is good news. God's not angry with me. He's not angry with you. Now, he doesn't like sin, but he loves me. Can you say that? God loves me. You need to feel comfortable saying that. God loves me. He loves me. He delights in me. He doesn't delight always in what I do, but he loves me. You hear, there's a huge difference here. And see, the Bible says that God gave me the spirit of adoption. Romans 8, we just read, that I might cry out, Abba, Father, and that I'm now a child of God, literally a joint heir with Jesus. Now, that it brought me into a whole new place of being in Christ. I'm in him. He's in me. And that position is part of what the cross paid for. Now, I want to just talk briefly on that. If you have your Bibles, look at Ephesians chapter 1. They're having a lot of fun over there next door. What they're doing, show and tell over there. What those guys are doing. Ephesians chapter 1, beginning in verse 3, it says, we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. Isn't that amazing? We have been given everything, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, in him. In him we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose which it works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory in him. That position of being in Christ, that is part of what we are supposed to be walking in, the identity of really being in Christ. My identity is that I'm a child of God. Your identity is that you're a child of God. Now, I want you to think about what the scripture says here. The Bible said that we were forgiven. So not only am I forgiven, and I have been literally cleansed from sin, but it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that I'm now the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But you know, you can feel forgiven, and you can be made righteous and still not feel like you're part of the family. But it goes on to say that not only have we been forgiven, we've been justified, we've been reconciled to God, we have been made friends of God, literally, we've been restored to relationship and to intimacy with God. Now, that's not all. We're adopted into the family. I mean, we're accepted in the beloved, and we've literally been made joint heirs with Jesus. I mean, not only, you can be forgiven and still be outside. But see, what the cross did was not only just forgive us, but it brought us inside. And it made us acceptable to God the Father, through the Son, by the power of the Holy Spirit. That now, not only are we just sort of members of the family, but we're brought back and restored into intimacy. Now that's the place that God has always wanted. From the very beginning, He created us so that we might know Him and that we might have intimacy with Him. God wants us to know His love, but He wants to know who we are and who He is in us. And back to a place of intimacy. Through the cross, we have been blessed with everything. God has not withheld anything from us. So He's given to us everything, and it's time for us to begin to walk in that total victory. There's scriptures throughout that talk about our position of being in Christ, and there's so much there. But the reality is that we have been given everything. Now, I want to move right on over to the exchange of the cross, because I want us to talk about this. It says that we have, as any kind of an inheritance, the only way you get inheritance, somebody has to die. If somebody dies and they leave you in the will, then you receive an inheritance. Well, Jesus died, and He left us His will, which is His word, and it contains so many promises for us, and they're for us. But you've got to understand what they are so we can walk them out and live them out in our lives. But I want to talk about Ephesians 1:3 we just read. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places." 2 Peter 1:3 says that His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Ephesians 1:11 says that in Him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of Him who works all things according to the counsel of His will. And Colossians 1:12 says, "Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us as to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the life." And Galatians 3:26 says, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. For as many of you were baptized into Christ to put on Christ, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seeds and heirs according to the promise." That means that we have an inheritance. That inheritance was paid for by the cross. And if we'll begin to appropriate this into our lives, we'll begin to see the victory that God has for us. Now, there's 10 things here I want to cover. We're going to minister on a couple of these as we go along. If you'll turn with me to Isaiah 53, Isaiah prophesied nearly 700 years before the time of Christ. And in Isaiah 53, we have one of the longest sections there that talks about Christ. I know you're familiar with this, but I want us to just look at it. What an awesome passage this is. I'm going to begin in verse 3, Isaiah 53. "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from Him. He was despised, and we did not esteem Him. Surely He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed Him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon Him, and by His stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. The Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and He was afflicted, yet He opened not His mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before its shearer is silent, He opened not His mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. Who will declare His generation? For He was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people He was stricken. And they made His grave with the wicked, but with the rich at His death, because He had done no violence. There was any deceit in His mouth. Yet it pleased the Father to bruise Him. He was put Him to grief. When you made His soul an offering for sin, He shall see His seed, He shall prolong His days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in His hand." Isn't that amazing that it pleased the Father for the Son to be crushed. What an awesome demonstration of the love. But what I want to point out here is in this passage, there are a number of exchanges that we're going to look at. Number one is, he was literally punished for us. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. I mean, the peace that, you remember it says, peace I give to you. It's not like the world gives, but I give to you. I've already overcome the world. Peace and joy, that's part of our inheritance. I believe that, and again, peace and joy has nothing to do with what's going on in the circumstances of life. It has all to do with knowing who Jesus is and the power and the victory of the Lord that he's paid for us. But he wants us to have peace. He wants to have joy. He wants us to live that way. And regardless of what the circumstances are going on in our life or the situations we find ourselves in, he wants us to live in peace and joy. But the chastisement, the punishment that was literally due us, it fell on Jesus. Wow, what good news. He was crushed, literally, is what that word means, bruised. He was crushed for our iniquities. He has borne our griefs. He was stricken. He was smitten, verse 4 says, by God. That is amazing to me. Colossians 2:13-14 says that you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting requirement that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Now, you know that I still find a lot of people in church, I know John would agree with this, that still struggle with knowing they're forgiven. They struggle with that. Now, I want to take just a moment right now. If you struggle with that guilt, that, you know, well, I've done so much, you don't understand what... I've had people tell me that I can't be forgiven. They go, I just can't be forgiven. You don't know what I've done. I go, it doesn't matter what you've done. See, it doesn't matter what you did. It matters what Jesus did. And Jesus said that while you were still a sinner, I went to the cross and died for you. He made a way so we could be completely forgiven. He took the punishment that was due us. Literally the certificates. There were certificates in those days that would be for the debtors, and they were, that certificate, Jesus just took it right off every one of us, and he nailed it to the cross. The certificate of death that was due me because I was a sinner, not only was I a sinner and born in sin, but I'm also a sinner, but all of that, it didn't matter what I did, it didn't matter how wicked or evil that was, that point in time when I realized that he took my sin, I go, thank you, Jesus. You forgave me. But we need to really be forgiven. I mean, you need to get that in your innermost being. I believe there's sicknesses that have attached themselves because we haven't appropriated the fullness that we're forgiven. Listen, I'm forgiven. Spirit, soul, and body, I'm forgiven. I have been made the righteous of God. I'm forgiven. Now, if you struggle with that, I'd just like for you to stand up. If you struggle with anything about guilt or shame, we want to pray right now and ask the Lord to deal with that. Don't be embarrassed. We do a deliverance ministry called Free Indeed, and we go and pray for people and do all kinds of stuff. And I tell the people, look, I've stood up for every one of them. I want to be free. Don't you want to be free? Now, will some of y'all just extend your hands and go over and just bless these? There's some standing up. Now, just release the ministry to these. There's some over here. I don't see any others. But if you want prayer, just stand up. Let people pray for you. We're going to release. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that by the Spirit you would release a revelation that they're forgiven. I pray, Lord, that you would hit in deep inside in the innermost being a revelation that, Lord, that the chastisement for their peace and joy, their forgiveness, was upon you at the cross. And I ask, Lord, that you give them revelation that they're forgiven, completely forgiven, completely released from the penalty of sin. And, Lord, I speak to their soul and to their spirit, and I say, you are forgiven in Jesus' name. You are forgiven in Jesus' name. The word says that whatever sins you retain are retained, and whatever sins that you lose, they are loosed. And we speak forgiveness in Jesus' name. We ask, Lord, that you would just begin to cause them to feel release. We're asking for a release in the innermost being. Release, Lord. Release that forgiveness. And Lord, touch them deep. Touch them, Lord. Touch them. Forgiveness. You are forgiven. When Jesus was on the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And when he said that, he didn't put a qualifier on it. He didn't put a qualifier, forgive these three that are standing here. Forgive those that act holy. No, he said, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. And he released forgiveness into this world, and that is love in action. And we're releasing that forgiveness. Revelation of forgiveness. Revelation, you are forgiven. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to make it so real. Get it deep, deep, deep down inside of every one of us. Lord, we are so grateful for forgiveness. Now, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking, there's some of you that, I don't know if any of you that are standing or sick, but I'm asking that your physical bodies would respond to forgiveness in the name of Jesus. I'm asking, Lord, that you would release healing to their physical bodies in the name of Jesus. I'm asking, Lord, that their bodies, their soul and spirit would respond to forgiveness. And you did begin to just release, they'd kick off that sickness. And Lord, we're asking for a release in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, we're so grateful. Thank you for healing us and for the forgiveness of sin. Okay, we're going to continue on. If you want more prayer, we're going to pray here at the end. I'm not going to go a whole lot longer, but we're going to keep praying. This is a real issue. If you could get that, the Bible says in 1 John that little children know their sins are forgiven. I felt like the Lord showed me a long time ago that those stages, there's the young child or the child stage, there's the young man stage, and the father stage. Now, God wants us to grow up into all those stages, but the first stage is that you know your sins are forgiven. And we need to believe that our sins were completely forgiven, that our punishment was upon him. Now, the second thing we want to talk about is that he literally took our sin upon himself. He took our sin so we could be made the righteous of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Now, not only are we forgiven, but we need to start believing that we're righteous. Now, we've taught everybody that, you know, we've gone around and taught everybody, you know, you're just no low-down sinner saved by grace. Well, I was a sinner. I'm not a sinner any longer. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. And I am the righteous of God in Christ Jesus. I don't always act righteous, but I am righteous. You hear what I'm saying? This is huge. Mindset, paradigm has to shift. I am not a sinner. I am a saint. I'm not a sinner that hoping I can make it. If I can just do enough good stuff, get to heaven. No, I was a sinner, but now I'm a saint. I have been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, and I am a child of God, a joint heir with Jesus. I live and reign in Christ Jesus. I am more than a conqueror through him who strengthens me. I live and reign in Christ Jesus. Now, I can sin, but I'm a saint, washed by the blood, forgiven, healed. I mean, I'm a new creation. This isn't even home. I mean, this earthly dwelling is, you know, groaning for that totality of being clothed with Christ. What happened? But I'm changed. I'm not a makeover. I'm somebody totally, absolutely different. The devil doesn't want you to know that. He wants you to say, oh, no, I'm just no sinner. I'm not worth anything. You're worth Jesus' life on the cross. How much is that worth? Wow. Man, I'm the righteous God. I'm not, here again, I'm not always righteous, but I am the righteousness of God. God loves me. He washed me. He forgave me. You know, I am totally changed. 1 John 1, 8-9 says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sin and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. God is so good. See, He knows He made me righteous, but He knows that I live in a fallen world, and every once in a while I can sin. So He says, okay, I can even make provision for that too. If you'll just confess it and turn from it, what does the Bible say? He is faithful. We sang the song over and over and over. God is faithful. I'm not faithful. But He is always faithful. It says in Timothy, He cannot deny Himself because He's faithful. Oh, that's good news. I mean, see, even forgiveness and walking in righteousness is not based upon me doing everything right. If I mess up, He says, hey, I made provision for you. Now, we need to learn how to just walk in this. I mean, the Holy Spirit will convict you of sin. The Holy Spirit will never condemn you. Little lesson here, real quickly. The devil condemns you. The difference between condemnation and guilt, I mean, the condemnation and conviction is real easy. Condemnation is always against you. Well, you're just a sorry person. You always mess up. You're always doing this, or it's always directed toward you. God never does that. He will say, that attitude was sin, Terry. You shouldn't have, you know, the way you said that, that wasn't good. That thought, this and this, but He'll never condemn me because He loves me. He loves me, but He will convict me of sin. But we need to learn the difference because it's such a huge difference. The devil just wants to beat us up. Okay, does that make sense? Now, look at Isaiah 53:3. We'll look at another thing. It says, He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from Him. He was despised, and we did not esteem Him. One of the meanest things that we deal with is rejection. Now, the love of the Father is what, you know, the rejection is basically just the absence of real meaningful love. And when you've been rejected as a child, or even been rejected from the womb, there are a lot of people that are literally not wanted. But Jesus dealt with that because He was rejected. He literally was rejected. He took our rejection so that we could be accepted in the beloved. Because Ephesians 1, verses 4 through 6, that just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise and the glory of His grace, by which He made us accepted in the beloved. Now, this is huge. I know lots of people that struggle with rejection. You know, self-rejection, feelings of rejection, not feeling totally accepted. But if you'll understand this part of the exchange of the cross, Jesus was rejected by all. Now, the truth is that for a moment, even the Father, when He became sin, turned away from Him. Now, I don't think we have any concept of what that would be like. But He was rejected. People rejected Him. They turned from Him. His own disciples turned from Him. He took your rejection. And it's time for us to literally let go of the hurt and the pain and the rejection. And if whatever cause it came from, wherever it came from, we need to let go of that rejection and receive the acceptance of a holy God that loved us so much. And if you struggle with rejection, I'm going to ask you to stand. Because it's time to release this into your life. God wants to release, again, that spirit of adoption upon you. Isn't that good news? It's all His choosing. Woo! It's not based on performance. I'm going to break the power of that performance orientation in your lives. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we're asking for Your love again to come. We ask You, Holy Spirit, to release the spirit of adoption upon these people. Lord, I pray for everybody in here, Lord, that we get a greater revelation of the love of the Father and the spirit of adoption. And Lord, I take authority over that lying spirit that says that we're rejected in the name of Jesus. I rebuke that spirit, and I say, you loose us, and you go in the name of Jesus. You are a liar, and we will not receive you any longer in Jesus' name. Lord, we have been paid for by the blood. We've been redeemed, and Lord, we have been sanctified, and Lord, now we've been chosen of God and accepted in the beloved. Now receive it. Just receive it. Receive the spirit of adoption. Receive it. Receive the love of the Father in a deeper way. Receive that spirit of adoption. Beloved, you are chosen of God. Now, all that performance orientation we take authority over. And we ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that by the Spirit you would root it out of our lives. That no longer would we perform to be accepted because, Lord, you performed so we could be accepted. Lord, you broke the power of all of that works on our behalf. And by grace, we have been saved. We've been filled with the Spirit. Everything is by your grace. Everything is by your love. Everything is by the cross. And Lord, in the mighty and holy name of Jesus, Lord, we ask that that spirit of adoption would come upon us. Oh, Lord, more. More, Lord. More. More. More, Lord. More, Lord. Now, rejection, you have to go. All rejection. We pull that rejection out by the roots all the way back to the womb and say, you loose us and you go in the name of Jesus. We are not rejected any longer. We are accepted in the beloved. Oh, Lord, we love you. Now, some of you, just take a deep breath. Let that thing out. Say, get out of here. All rejection, all performance orientation, go in the name of Jesus. And just start thanking Him. That's it. Just receive it. Take a deep breath of the spirit of adoption. Let that peace and joy come upon you. Gotta go. All that rejection. All that rejection's gotta go. Now we're gonna keep going deeper here. We're gonna get some more stuff out too. Now say, I'm not rejected. I'm a child of God. I've been given the spirit of adoption. I'm a joint heir with Jesus. He chose me. I'm chosen. I'm loved. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for loving me and giving your life for me. Now I make the exchange. I receive your acceptance and I give you my rejection. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you took my rejection so I could be accepted. In Jesus' name. Amen. Isn't that good? Now, you got to walk in that, though. The truth will make you free. It will make you free. We got to have the truth and we got to have the Spirit. Both together helping us to walk this out. But this truth the devil doesn't want us to know. But, I mean, we are chosen of God, children of God. Boy, that's good news. All these things are so, there's so much good news. No wonder you call it good news. I mean, the gospel's good news. I tell people, what would you like? God says, I've set before you life and death. You choose. I think I choose life. When you want to choose life? Why would anybody want to choose death? Well, the next thing it says that Jesus was literally reconciled. I mean, because he was cut off by the Father, we're reconciled to him. Isaiah 53, it says, for he was cut off from the land of the living for the transgression of my people. He was literally stricken. On the cross, Jesus himself quotes Psalm 22. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was forsaken for that brief moment so literally we could be joined to the Father. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's amazing. Wow, that is amazing. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:18-20, it says, now all things are of God who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the whole world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Now we are reconciled to God because of what Jesus did at the cross. Isn't that amazing? Now, another thing that Jesus did at the cross, He bore our shame. He literally took our shame so we could share in His glory. Isaiah 53:3 says He was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, as we did, we hid our faces from Him. He was despised, and we did not esteem Him. Surely He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. We esteemed Him stricken, smitten by God, afflicted, but He was wounded for our transgressions. Isaiah 61 says that instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. Instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. Shame is like condemnation. Shame attacks your personhood. Guilt, there can be guilt response for something you've done. Guilt can be good or bad. Guilt can take you to repentance, or guilt can turn into condemnation. But shame is something the enemy tries to put it upon us. If he can get shame upon us, you can't get it off. Because it's just like, God, I'm dirty. I'm bad. I'm faulty. That's what the devil says. The devil says, there's something wrong with you. You know, there's something wrong with you. No. That is shame. That's condemnation from the devil. Now, Jesus literally bore our shame. He carried our sorrows and our pain, and literally so that we could be free. Now, if you're still struggling with things of the past, now, we've talked about being forgiven. We've talked about that rejection. We're reconciled to God, but still you can carry shame. You can feel dirty. It was something done to me, or it was something that I did. See, God wants to heal that. And so if that would apply to you, I want to ask you to stand. Anybody here just wants shame off and guilt and feel like you're just dirty? I mean, God, you have a hard time receiving that love. Susan, why don't you come up here and join me, Ellen? Now, I'm going to read this again over you. Just receive this. Instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. Instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in your portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. And God wants to, He wants to wash us right now. He took your shame. Now, as we pray, I want to ask you to literally see yourselves giving your shame and giving that hurt and giving whatever was done to you or whatever caused that pain or hurt, that sorrow, give it to the Lord. Literally see the exchange of the cross. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking to make this exchange real in all of our lives. Lord, You said that You took our pain, You took our sorrows, You literally bore our shame. So, Lord, if You took it, then we give it to You. Now, just see yourself giving that worthlessness that the enemy has put upon you. Some of you, that's been spoken over your life by your own parents and by friends. You need to forgive them, and you need to release them. God just, He loves us, but you've got to release that and let it go. Give up the pain. Some of you have been abused. And in the name of Jesus, pain, you got to go. Pain, got to go. Pain, give it up. Give up the pain. Let it go. That the hurt and the pain, Jesus took it. He suffered pain. He suffered. Give it to Him. Let Him have it. Let it go. Let it go. Let go of that pain. Let it go. Got to go. Pain, come out in Jesus' name. Come out. Let it go. Let it go. Give it up. Give it up. Give that pain up. Just release it. Just give it up. Give up the shame right now. Give up all shame. It doesn't matter what you did. Receive forgiveness. And let the blood of Jesus cleanse you. And let you be, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
many of you have never heard your earthly father say and call you precious, that you're my own. And I feel like that the Heavenly Father wants you in your inner man to hear Him say, I call you precious. You are my child. You are my child. You're precious to me. Father, I just ask that you just bathe each and every one who stood up, and each and every one who just cries out, Father, we need to hear your voice. We need to hear you call me precious, your child. May we know the depth of the Father's love. May we know the depth of your heart to me. I thank you, Father, how you pull that the root of shame and hurt and rejection out by the very root, and that we can come boldly into your arms of love.
Now, Father, I ask that you release double honor. Double honor. I pray, Lord, you begin to give revelation of how much you love each and every one of us. And I pray, Lord, that you would release honor. And, Lord, we begin to see ourselves seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I pray, Lord, you begin to give us revelation that we're more than conquerors through you who strengthen us. I pray you begin to see that we are the chosen of God, the accepted of God. Oh, Lord, we love you. We just bless your holy name. Oh, Lord, release your joy, everlasting joy, everlasting joy. Now, some of you have got some pain that's sort of lodged. Let it go. Over this next few days that are here, release that pain to Jesus. Exchange it for His love and joy and honor. Release the shame. Release release all that stuff and receive the good. It's such a lopsided exchange. It's unbelievable. I mean, it just doesn't even make sense. But Jesus took all of our bad stuff and He gave us everything that He had. He didn't withhold anything from us, and He gave it all to us. Now, Lord, we love you, and we thank you. We receive, Lord, your double honor. I'm asking, Lord, for double honor to be released in these now, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Now, I want us to go on here. There's just a couple of more that we're going to talk about. But we've got to talk about the exchange of real sickness. You know, in Isaiah 53, it says he was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He literally bore our griefs and he carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Now, you could easily say, well, that's just spiritual healing. But the word that's used there is Jehovah Rapha, the same word Rapha. It means healing. And literally, that translation there, we use the word for griefs, could easily have been translated sickness and probably should have been. But it's literally what Jesus took upon himself, that by his broken body we can have wholeness. I think it's spirit, soul, and body. I don't think it's ever limited. God's always the God of the above and beyond, the more than abundantly, the much more. That's our God. But I believe that He wants us to receive healing. Now, Matthew 8:16-17, when Jesus was healing people, He was at Simon's mother and at Simon Peter's bungalow's house. He healed these people. Verse 17 says, it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, he himself took our infirmities and he bore our sicknesses. A direct reference to that. Then in 1 Peter 2:24, it says, he who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that having died to sin, might live for righteousness, and by his stripes you were healed. In Isaiah, which is 700 years before Christ, he is looking toward the cross, and he's saying that by your stripes you're healed. Then we know from the New Testament that the writer, by the Spirit, through Matthew, is saying, ties that together. And then in Peter, after the cross, he's looking back and saying, oh, by his stripes you were healed. Past tense. And so it's time for us to appropriate that into our lives. It's literally, he wants us to receive healing into our physical bodies. And he wants us to exchange our sicknesses for his healing. Now, how many are sick that are here right now? If you'll just stand up if you're sick. If there's sickness in your body and you need a physical healing, what I said before, I really do believe, I think a lot of sicknesses and a lot of diseases gain entrance because we don't fully appropriate the complete work of Jesus Christ. Because we just don't know. We've been duped, and, you know, and we don't know that. And I'm not saying that, you know, the Bible doesn't say you can't get sick. But I believe he provided for us to be healed. It doesn't mean you can't get sick. Well, let's get healed. And it doesn't mean that, you know, someday, obviously, we're going to die. I mean, until the last enemy, it says in 1 Corinthians 15, is death. And so we know that until Jesus comes back, that that enemy is still here. But I believe that God wants us to walk in health. I believe he wants to release a greater measure of healing than we've seen. I really believe the Spirit has spoken that he was going to release healing. I remember when we first met John and Carol, and we heard their own personal testimonies. They talked about how, very, I don't know if you remember, I'm sure you do, shared this a number of times, about how it's been in your heart to release healing. And that's what you were doing before the blessing part ever hit. I mean, you were praying for people, you were doing inner healing, you were doing deliverance, everything possible to try to help people get hopeful and get healed. It's always been his heart to do that. I think God wants to release a greater dimension of healing than we've ever seen. But I believe that God wants to release a greater dimension of walking in health than we've been walking in. I'm all for going to getting prayed and going. I mean, I want to go get prayed and get healed if I'm sick. But I believe it's time to appropriate the word of healing. God sent his word to heal me. He has sent his word. It became flesh. It dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. That the only begotten Son, that's Jesus. I mean, I believe he wants us to appropriate by faith. I speak to my body every day. I say, thank you, Lord, that I'm healed by your stripes. I thank you, Lord, that my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that you live and you give life to my body. The Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead lives within me to give life to my mortal body. I mean, I'm a child of God. I speak to my body. Receive forgiveness. Be whole. Be healed. Receive love. I mean, that may sound really, you may think, this guy needs, he needs somebody, he needs some help. But I mean, you got to speak the word. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. The best place to hear the word is coming out of your mouth. It is. It'll build you up. But speak the word. I speak to my body. I say, be whole in the name of Jesus. I speak to the blood. Blood, I've got the blood of Jesus. Blood be normal in the name of Jesus. I speak to my heart. Heart be normal in the name of Jesus. I speak to my muscles and my skeleton. Be normal. I want them to line up and come under the authority of the Word of God and obey the Word. Now, body, let's release healing. Let me just pray over these, and then we want to ask you to release your healing through us. Father, we thank you that right now we're going to make this exchange. We're going to exchange sickness for your health. Lord, just see yourself giving up your sickness and the frailties of your body and anything that is broken, anything that's not working properly, any cancer, you give it up right now to the Lord. So, Lord, I give it to you and receive health and healing in Jesus' name. Oh, Lord, we thank you. By your stripes, we were healed. And Lord, you sent your word to heal us, and your word is still alive. It's living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. Lord, your word is alive. It never returns void without accomplishing what you sent it forth to accomplish. And Lord, you told us to speak your word that you would follow it up with signs and wonders. So Lord, we're asking, Lord, now that you release healing, miracles, signs and wonders right here in the name of Jesus. Lord, we're asking for your power and your anointing in Jesus' name.
Father, I just ask, Lord, that you rain down your healing power. I come against all headache, that migraine headache, in Jesus' name. We break your power. We are blood bought by the blood of the Lamb. And I thank you, Father, that you paid the price. You gave your precious Son, Jesus.
why we're here. In the name of Jesus, we thank you that you became a curse so we could receive the blessing of Abraham. And so, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we just take authority over every curse, ancestral, generational curse in the name of Jesus, every bloodline curse. We cancel by the blood of the Lamb. We sever and cut off every curse, every kind of curse that's come upon us in Jesus' name. Lord, you became a curse. And Lord, we release that and we receive the blessing of Abraham now in the name of Jesus. Along with that healing, we release it in Jesus' name.
Yes, O Lord. Yes, O Lord. Yes, O Lord. Thank you, Father. Rise up in Jesus' name. Rise up, faith, in Jesus' name. Let that anointing break every yoke.
Now, Lord, we ask you to break the curse of poverty off our lives. Lord, you became poor so we could literally share your abundance. There is no shortage in heaven. And, Lord, we break that curse of poverty. And we ask, Lord, to be broken off our lives in the name of Jesus. The spirit of lack we command to go from us in the name of Jesus. There is no lack in the kingdom. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we just break that curse of poverty. We ask you to forgive us for not being faithful with our finances. But Lord, I ask, Lord, you release a faithfulness in us, Lord, that we might walk in a way that is rich toward you in Jesus' name. Just receive forgiveness now. If you've not been rich toward God, if you've not really sought the kingdom of God first, but you sought the other, then just ask him to forgive you. Receive forgiveness and cleansing and let it release into you favor and blessing of God in the name of Jesus. Oh, Lord, we're asking, Lord, to make this exchange of the cross so real in our lives. We're asking, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you would help us to make a complete exchange of all the junk in our lives, in our family's life, in our ancestors' lives. We're going to trade it all in this today for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your love, your abundance, your healing, your deliverance. Lord, we love you. Oh, we love you. We are so blessed by the cross. For it is the power of God for those of us who are being saved. Now, Lord, I pray you just release now more healing. More healing in Jesus' name. More. More, Lord. More. Exchange out that sickness and disease. Give it to the Lord. Give it to him completely. Now, and we're going to pray here in just a moment for everybody. It wants to be prayed for. We'll lay hands on you. If any of these areas that we've been talking about still you don't feel like a release, then we want to lay hands upon you and pray that God will release that. He does use us to lay hands, and just as he uses you too. But he wants us to, he really does want to release us. Now, I want to deal with one more thing in this exchange. You know, Jesus really did die our death. And the Lord wants to break the fear of death out of our lives. I believe that through the fear of death, the enemy uses that again to inflict us with sickness. You know, he goes, well, you're going to die. You're going to get that. You know, your mother died of that. Your father died of that. Your grandmother. I mean, you know, you're going to die. And that fear of death, folks, let me tell you, I'm already dead. I'm dead in Christ. But I live forevermore. I mean, we look at death as being the terminal. I mean, gosh, this is the end of the end. No, it's not. It's just a transition from a different dimension. But the fear of death keeps us from doing the things that God has called us to do. He keeps us from being bold. He keeps us from really receiving the things of God. And a lot of times we're not even aware that that thing's ministering to us. We're not even aware. But Jesus literally died our death. Jesus died my death on that cross. He did die. And he was buried. But the good news, folks, he's not in the grave. He's not hanging on that cross. But he is the resurrected King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he is seated at the right hand of the Father, as Jack shared this morning. He's waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. And he is not up there twiddling his thumbs and wringing his hands going, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? No. He's up there and he's going, I have the light in my children, and I'm waiting for them to rise up with my spirit, just as he did when he walked on the earth, empowered and anointed of the Holy Spirit, to live the same way. And that's exactly how he wants to live. He's got so much for us, but we've got to deal with that fear of death. So if the fear of dying and the fear of what that means has bothered you, I'm going to ask you to stand up. Again, don't be embarrassed if that's had any effect upon your life. And if there's any, let me ask you this, if any of you think that there's like an assignment of death that's against you, or like some, untimely death in your family, there's been some kind of stuff, but that fear of stand up will break that also. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that you died our death. And in the name of Jesus, we take authority over the spirit of death, and we break that assignment of death in the name of Jesus, and the fear of death in the name of Jesus. Now, see yourself, just give up that fear of death. All fear, we take authority over. We break the power of fear. You didn't give us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. And we will not entertain that spirit of death or that fear of dying in the name of Jesus. For Lord, we're dead in Christ. For we're children of the Most High God. We are joint heirs with you, Lord Jesus. You said that we are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And you always cause us to triumph in Christ Jesus. Now receive life. Receive life. Receive life. Receive the power of the resurrection. The power of the resurrection. The resurrected life. Receive it. And just walk in it and believe it. Death, loose these people and go from them in the name of Jesus. The fear of death, fear of dying, go in the name of Jesus. Lord, we love you and we bless your holy name. Now, we're going to pray here. We'll close in just a moment. I just want to encourage you again. The cross, the message of the cross is the power of God. Paul said, I came to you, I don't want to know anything but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I didn't come in superiority of speech or man's wisdom, but I came in power and demonstration of the Holy Spirit so that your faith wouldn't rest in man, but it rest in God. But He preached Christ crucified and raised from the dead. The message of the cross, it says, is for us who are being saved, it is the power of God. There is great power when we begin to appropriate by faith the reality and the truth of what Jesus, past tense, paid for 2,000 years ago. It's ours. We've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. We've been given everything that pertains to life and godliness in Christ Jesus. There's nothing that He's withheld from us. And the devil doesn't want us to walk in that freedom. He doesn't want us to walk in that reality. Because if we do, the life of Christ, that freedom that's within us, will affect the people that you're around. If we get free, we will free others. Free people. Heal people. People that know the love of the Father can release the love of the Father. But God wants that. He wants to release us into the power of the cross so we understand that, wait a minute, it has got nothing to do with me. It has all to do with Him. I mean, He paid in full for us to walk in this. Now, if you'll stand with me, I want to just pray over us. Now, remember, at the cross, He completely and absolutely defeated the enemy. But we haven't talked about that. We don't have enough time. But I want to pray over us and pray that God would release, again, revelation of His love and His grace and His mercy and the power of the cross. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You for the cross. I thank You, Lord, that You died that death for me, that You literally took my sin upon Your body so I could be forgiven. I thank You, Lord, that You became a curse so I could receive the blessing of Abraham. I thank You, Lord, that by Your stripes that You took my sickness, You bore my pain, You took it upon Yourself so I could be healed. I could know Your goodness. You took my shame so I could share in Your glory. You took my poverty so I could share in Your abundance. And Lord, You died my death so I could share Your life. Now, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray that the message of the cross, you would help us to have revelation of the cross of Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, that every time we see the cross, that we would be immediately reminded of your awesome love for us. I pray, Lord, that when we see something that looks like the cross, we'd just go, wow, wow, how much you love me. Not that you love the world, but that you love me personally. Lord, every time that we see the cross, we're reminded that we are children of God because of the cross and what you paid for us to have. Lord, I pray you'd remind us of the exchange of the cross. I pray, Lord, that you'd convict us and show us that, Lord, we can exchange that out. I don't have to keep that any longer. And Lord, I pray that you'd give us understanding and revelation that you made an open and public display of the enemy having triumphed over him. That, Lord, that you defeated the works of darkness, that you broke the power of the enemy, and you defeated the devil at the cross absolutely and completely. You said that there is exceeding greatness is toward us who believe. The same power that raised you from the dead, that seated you in heavenly places above all principality, power, rule, and might, and dominion, and name, and everything. For that power is toward us, if we'll believe. Lord, give us revelation of the victory of the cross. And then, Lord, give us revelation of the power of the cross. And, Lord, that when we identify with your death, burial, and resurrection, and, Lord, that we're dead in Christ, but we've been raised to walk in newness of life. And, Lord, let the power of resurrected life come into our being. Now, just receive. Just receive. Receive resurrected life. Peace and joy and love and grace and mercy and favor. Favor. Lord, let your favor be released. Lord, let revelation of favor be released. Lord, there's some in here that they haven't had any favor in their life. Let favor begin to be released. Favor. Oh, Lord, let your favor be released. Now, Lord, we thank you. Lord, it's just awesome. What an awesome thing that you would go to that cross. That, Lord, that you would be beaten by your own creators, their own creation. You created us. You would take the pain and the suffering, the mocking, the stripes to the face, the crown that was pushed into your brow and caused the pain and the bleeding, and to be nailed to that cross and to suffer that pain for each and every one of us. I pray, Lord, now in the name of Jesus, that you would give us a revelation of all that you did at the cross. And I pray, Lord, that you'd give us revelation that you're not on that cross and you're not in that grave, but you are the resurrected King of Kings, Lord of Lords, that you rule and reign, that your kingdom is forever. And Lord, we thank you for the cross. Now I pray, Lord, you just continue to give us revelation of the cross of Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, that you would release and help us to know that the cross is the key, that the message of the cross is the power of God in Jesus' name. We love you and we bless you in Jesus' name. Now, if you want prayer for anything at all, we're going to come down and pray. We've got a few of the prayer team around, and we'll just pray for you as long as you want prayer. But otherwise, you're released, and we love you and bless you. Amen.